Assalamu alaikum class. So today we are going to discuss the scope of mother and child health. As I have already mentioned in my last lecture, that one of the important component of reproductive health is safe motherhood, and safe motherhood targets three important components of maternal care, which include the antenatal care, natal care, and the postnatal care. Another important component of the reproductive health is the care of the newborn. Why this entity is taken as a separate segment of community medicine? Because a larger proportion of mothers and children are at high risk. They can expect mortality and morbidity. We have highest maternal mortality rate when we compare it with the indicators of the Southeast Asia. We have high infant mortality rate. We have high mortality rate in under 5 children. So that's why it makes an important segment of the population which is at high risk. Number two, the population structure of Pakistan shows that the base of the population pyramid is made up of children under 5 years of age, and that constitutes a large number, as the total fertility rate of Pakistani women is really high. So this is an important component of community medicine. So today we will be discussing that what is the significance of MCH services. As I have already mentioned, that they constitute a larger component of the population and they are at high risk population. So we want to offer them services according to their needs. We want to provide them extra care and we want to work for the Safe Motherhood Initiative as well. The rationale of MCH, what are the major public health issues of maternal and child health? What is Safe Motherhood Initiative, and then what are the components of the antenatal care? These are the learning outcomes of today's lecture. So moving towards the maternal and child health, why maternal and child health is important? Because we want to provide them healthcare services according to their need. As I have already mentioned, that they are high-risk population and they can die very early. We have high maternal mortality rate, we have high infant mortality rate, we have a high mortality of children under 5 years of age. So we have to provide them with comprehensive healthcare services to reduce the mortality and morbidity in this high-risk population. So in comprehensive healthcare services, we provide four types of services. Number one is promotive services. Why do we want to promote their health? Because we want to maintain their health if they are in a healthy status. We want to promote the healthy lifestyle. We want to promote healthy diet. We want to promote the healthy pattern of sleep and exercise. We want to promote the positive intake of multivitamins and other food ingredients. And we want to promote those habits which can maintain their health. The second component of the healthcare service provision to MCH, means maternal and child health, is the preventive type of services. These preventive type of services basically target the specific protection. And in specific protection, we give immunization services. As you already know, that tetanus toxoid vaccination is targeted for the pregnant women, and we have almost 12 vaccines which are targeted in expanded program of immunization to prevent certain diseases in children under 2 years of age who can prevent their mortality. In preventive services, we can also give them health education. And we can prevent certain specific components which can lead to disastrous effects. For example, if a pregnant woman is a smoker, so we can give health education to her and tell her that this smoking can lead to intrauterine growth retardation of the child or the newborn baby. So you have to prevent this intrauterine growth retardation by reducing your smoking or by cessation of your smoking activities. Again, for prevention, for example, if a female is diagnosed with a case of pregnancy-induced hypertension, we can give specific protection and we can tell them, give them health education that you have to reduce the salt intake in your diet so your blood pressure is maintained, which can end up in disastrous effects in stillbirths and in fetal loss if it is not maintained. So preventive services basically target the specific protective measures for the betterment of the maternal and child healthcare services. The third component in the healthcare service provision of MCH is the curative services. For example, if we find any complication or any disease which is associated in pregnancy and it is acting as a comorbidity in pregnancy, we have to cure that disease. For example, if a female who is pregnant and who has tuberculosis, we have to cure that tuberculosis in the following successive stages of the pregnancy as well. And if she is suffering from hypertension, if there is diabetes during pregnancy, or any other complication during the pregnancy, it can be obstetrical complication, it can be any associated medical complication, we have to cure that disease. And then rehabilitative services, once the mother has given birth to the newborn baby, now is the time for restoration of her health and for the rehabilitative services, and we target them in the postnatal care and the postnatal care of the safe motherhood. So going into detail, we provide all the four services targeting the mother and child health care service provision. During the MCH services, I have already mentioned that we have to give them health education, that your caloric requirement is increased and you have to take care of your nutrition, you have to take multivitamins, you have to increase your weight gain, and we have to give health promotion about the better use of nutrition. We have to give health education about the avoidance of drugs which can have disastrous effect during pregnancy. The example is the use of thalidomide. Example is use of tetracyclines during pregnancy. Example is use of some drugs which can cause congenital malformations, use of radiations during pregnancy, etc. We have to target the infections which can lead to preterm labor, which can lead to severe urinary tract infection, which can precipitate labor, and not only targeting the physical health of the mothers as well, we have to target the activities which improve the mental health and the social health as well. And when we talk about the provision of MCH services, we have to keep into consideration that MCH services cannot be given alone, only targeting the mothers and the children. We have to incorporate the activities of the partner as well as the extended family members to maintain the mental health and the social health of the mother and the children. As we will be moving forward with this chapter, we will be discussing many cultural aspects and many social aspects which are affecting the health of the mothers. And we must know that the extended family members and the pressure of in-laws cause lots of stress on the mental health of the expected mother. So we have to take into consideration not only the partners but also the extended family members to give a comprehensive healthcare service provision to this pregnant lady. When we talk about the major MCH problem, one of the major indicators which indicates that we are not providing adequate healthcare services to the pregnant ladies is the maternal mortality rate. It indicates that a large number of females die during the pregnancy or labor or in the postpartum period. According to WHO, no woman should die in pregnancy or in childbirth. But when we look into the indicators, in 1990, there were 5,32,000 deaths were occurring. And in 2015, these have been reduced, but 3,03,000 deaths are still occurring worldwide. So it means, and these indicators have not yet improved a lot in the year 2020. So other major problems are that many of the pregnant females are malnourished in Pakistan. A large majority is suffering from anemia. And if the pregnant female is suffering from anemia, definitely the fetus has low reserves of iron, and it can affect their growth. It can affect their mental development as well. There are a large number of infections, vaginal infections, sexually transmitted infections, which can affect the outcome of the pregnancies as well. There is a major problem of uncontrolled reproduction where women do not have the right to choose for their pregnancy. They cannot control their pregnancy. They cannot make decisions about having this pregnancy or aborting this pregnancy. The uncontrolled reproduction can be actually targeted by providing comprehensive healthcare services, including the family planning services to these pregnant ladies as well. So, hemorrhages is one of the problem in Pakistan. Almost 20% of the females report with antepartum hemorrhage, and almost 12% of the females in the postpartum period report with postpartum hemorrhage. And these two are one of the major reasons of maternal mortality in Pakistan. Pregnancy-induced hypertension is again another important issue with pregnant mothers. It is seen in the younger age lot, as well as in the multi-gravida ladies. So we have to be able to identify the signs of pregnancy-induced hypertension leading towards preeclampsia and eclampsia. When we talk about the labor, the obstructed labor and the prolonged labors can result not only in mortality, but they can also result in morbidity. And majority of the times, the females who have delivered by dies in their homes, they have ended up in tertiary healthcare hospitals with the formation of fistulas. And these uterovaginal fistulas other fistulas can affect the quality of life of the lady. And this is one of the major complications which is being observed in Pakistani population. So we have a large number of problems which target the pregnant ladies, and I am for the time being skipping the child health problems as we will be discussing them in the section when we will be targeting child health. So maternal mortality rate, the highest maternal mortality rate as we look into the regional distribution is reported in Africa, which is the least developed region of the world. And about 50% of the mortalities which occur globally are basically contributed by the African pregnant ladies. And then after Africa, the Southeast Asia has the highest maternal mortality when we compare it with the other regions of the world. And again, then in Southeast Asia, Pakistan has the highest mortality. Even the maternal mortality rate is higher than Bangladesh and India in Pakistan, which indicates the lack of provision of healthcare services to the pregnant ladies in Pakistan. So the components of maternal and child health, again, I have already mentioned that they are divided into the care of mothers and care of children. And when we talk about care of mother, we target all the three areas. The antenatal care means the care which is provided during pregnancy. Intranatal care or natal care means the care which should be provided during delivery and during labor. And the postnatal care is the care which should be provided after the delivery, and it should extend up to the 40 days of the puerperium. Regarding the care of the children, it includes the component of the newborn care soon after the delivery, and then in the postnatal care, we also provide services for the provision of health to the newborn babies. We have to take care of low birth weight babies and preterm babies, and how do we manage it, and what are the risk factors which are associated, what are the complications we have to cover, and how do we deal with them. Then in the child health, we are concerned about their feeding habits. Are they breastfed or are they bottle fed? And if they are bottle fed, how much dilution is done, which feed is given to them? And then how they show growth and development. So these all encompass the initial part of the life along with the of the children under 5 years of age, along with the care of the mother. What are the important indicators of MCH? As I have already mentioned, one of the important indicators is the maternal mortality rate, and the another important indicator is the maternal mortality ratio. And we all know that if we are concerned with the death of the pregnant women during pregnancy or during labor and after 40 days after the labor, if we take it out of the total married female population, that indicates actually the true representation of maternal mortality rate. But we have discussed in our chapter of demography in detail that it is impossible to get the denominator, as majority of the females in Pakistani population do not report their pregnancy until and unless there is complication and they do not go to the hospital. So we do not have that denominator. We do not have the reporting system which tells us about the total number of pregnant married females who are passing through the pregnancy up till the labor. And we do not have record of postpartum period. We do not have record of the abortion services. So we do not have that denominator. So in other developed developing countries like India and Bangladesh, the Pakistan is also using an indicator in which the denominator is the live births. So we actually calculate the maternal mortality in relation to the live births which are occurring in a specific particular area in a specific time period. So in a true sense, it is actually maternal mortality ratio. But to compare it internationally, we take it as maternal mortality rate. And we have discussed it in detail already. Going towards the indicators of child health, we want to know what is the percentage of the low birth weight babies which are actually being born in Pakistan in 1 year. What is the incidence of preterm babies per year, occurrence of these babies who have not completed the term? Then we are interested in knowing that what is the infant mortality rate, what is the neonatal mortality rate. Again, the neonatal mortality rate is divided into early neonatal and the late neonatal mortality rate. And we all know that early neonatal mortality rate is up to the death of the neonate up to the 7 days of their birth is known as early neonatal mortality. And from 8th day onwards up to the 28th days of the birth, it is taken as late neonatal mortality rate. And when we combine early neonatal with late neonatal mortality rate, we calculate the neonatal mortality rate. We have another indicator, which is perinatal mortality rate, which takes into consideration the stillbirths. And again, the perinatal mortality rate is an indirect indicator of the maternal health as well. Going towards the Safe Motherhood Initiative, which we have already discussed in our last lecture, the Safe Motherhood Initiative, which is taken under the Reproductive Health Package, which was announced by the United Nations. The first and important component of the safe motherhood is the antenatal care. And we will be discussing antenatal care today. So antenatal care is basically defined as the care or the healthcare service provision which is given to a pregnant female. And it is the comprehensive healthcare service, as I have already mentioned, that we not only take care of physical health, but we also want to target the mental health and the social health of this pregnant woman as well. This antenatal care starts from the history taking, counseling, examinations, observations, health education, guidance, and early diagnosis, treatment, complication prevention, and disability limitations, and then going towards the rehabilitative services if they are required. So it's a comprehensive health package which is given to a pregnant female. Basically, the goal is to reduce the maternal mortality, maternal morbidity, and perinatal mortality, as I have already mentioned. We want to target physical, mental, and social well-being of the women and the children. And what are the basic objectives of MCH? Number one is to promote, protect, and maintain health of the pregnant lady, which we have discussed in detail. Number two is that we want to identify the high-risk cases which cannot be treated in the primary settings, and they need referrals. This is very, very important that we should identify the high risk cases as soon as possible, and we should develop proper referral system for them. Number three is to detect complications, the associated comorbidities, and provide treatment for them. Another objective of provision of MCH services is to reduce anxiety, to reduce the indicators which are used for the comparison at the national level, regional level, and international level, where we compare the maternal mortality rates and ratios, infant mortality rates and ratios. Another important component is to give health education to this pregnant lady who comes to us. We have to give health education regarding their nutrition, their sleep pattern, their eating pattern, their exercise pattern. We have to tell them and counsel them about the outcomes of the pregnancy. We have to give health education about all the aspects in which she desires to take this health education. Fine. And there are WHO standards for the health education to these females. Another important component is that the WHO strongly recommends that the family planning should be introduced to the pregnant lady as soon as she visits for the antenatal care to a health physician or to any primary healthcare worker in the community, because this is the time period when she is more receptive for the family planning services, and she should be introduced about all the services which she can avail. And she should be counseled to bring her partner into this decision making. And another important objective is that if required, we can opt for termination of pregnancy. And although you all know that Pakistani law and Islam doesn't allow the termination of pregnancy, but there are certain conditions in which the therapeutic abortions are allowed. And these therapeutic abortions are allowed if the health of the mother is compromised, and if the fetus has a condition which can end up in difficulty in surviving soon after the pregnancy is finished, or there are certain life-threatening conditions, they can be taken into account for taking into consideration the option of therapeutic abortion. Another important component of MCH is that if the mother has a child less than 5 years of age who is accompanying this particular mother, we have to attend this under five children as well. So it covers the 3/4 of the family. So moving towards the required antenatal visits, WHO says that minimum 8 visits, WHO says that 8 contacts should be done of a pregnant lady with a healthcare provider. And the first visit should be as soon as the pregnancy is reported. Then for first 7 months, once she should visit per month. And then in the later 2 parts of the months in which the pregnancy is up to 8 to 9 months, then the visits should be more frequent. They should be done fortnightly. And the last month, from 9 months till labor, the visits, these antenatal visits should be actually per week. So they should be encountered as 4 times per month. This is the WHO recommendation for a normal antenatal visit schedule. But in the countries where the resources are less and the females do not have that much autonomy, and most of them are working, some of them are in the rural area where access to healthcare service provision is less, the minimum recommended visits are 4. It is being advised by the WHO that first visit should be done within first 12 weeks of pregnancy. The second visit should be between 14 to 26 weeks of pregnancy. Third visit should be between 28 to 34 weeks, and then fourth visit should be after 36 weeks in term, and this is the minimum recommended visits. Ideally, according to WHO, there should be 8 visits, but in those countries where the resources are less, where healthcare service provision is inadequate, where the females cannot go to the healthcare provider, or there is lack of funds, or there is lack of transport availability. The minimum recommended visits are 4, and these are given within the 12 weeks as the first visit, and the fourth visit should be between 36 weeks and term. When a female comes to you for antenatal care, the assessment should be done in 3 major subcomponents. Number 1, a detailed history should be taken. Number 2, detailed examination should be done. And number 3, investigations should be done. And in addition to this, health education and counseling sessions must be conducted. Moving towards each component, history taking, we'll move towards the obstetric history first. If a female comes to you with a history of amenorrhea and she says that she is pregnant, then the you have to take a history of the last menstrual period, which is known as LMP. And on the basis of LMP, you have to calculate the expected date of delivery. For this particular person, you have to take the previous obstetrical history, that how many times she got pregnant, which shows the gravita situation, and then how many living children that she have, and how many deaths have occurred, which shows the parity, and then the number of abortions she has undergone. So these actually include the total number of pregnancies, total number of living children, total number of deaths of children, and total number of abortions which she has undergone during her marital lifespan. Then you have to take history about the previous modes of deliveries, that whether these were normally delivered, they were delivered through cesarean sections, or it was for forceps delivery, whether it was a stillbirth, whether it was a normal healthy baby who died afterwards, or if the baby is still surviving, was there any history of preterm labor. So all obstetrical history is taken, which is of most important in this particular scenario. Then other histories should also be component. For example, you have to take the medical history, that is there any associated comorbidity in relation to this pregnancy. For example, there can be diabetes, hypertension, they are already present in this female, or the female is suffering from tuberculosis, which is very common in Pakistan, or is there any associated infection, for example, malaria and dengue according to the seasonal variation. So you have to take medical history, you have to take history about the allergies, you have to take history about blood transfusion, and if there any associated transfusion reaction has occurred or not, or any infection in the reproductive tract system or the sexually transmitted infection, the history should be taken. Regarding surgical history, any previous surgery which is done on this pregnant lady, and particularly if she has undergone cesarean sections, and the number of cesarean sections she has gone, because as the number of cesarean sections increases, it increases the chances of getting this pregnancy labeled as high-risk pregnancy. Then we are much more interested in getting the social history as well, that whether this pregnant lady, what is her education, and is she a working woman, what is her occupation, is she involved in smoking and alcohol. And you will be amazed to know that majority of the females in our rural settings are indulged in hookah smoking. So many of the youth in Pakistani population who belongs to elite class are cigarette smokers as well. So this makes an important significant history in Pakistan now, but in the initial time period, 10 to 15 years before this time, the smoking was not very much prevalent in Pakistani population, and the teenage pregnancy in developed countries is associated with a large number of smoker teenage girls. Alcohol is not a problem in Pakistani population, but WHO recommends that you have to take history of alcohol if a pregnant female comes to you, and this can also lead to the fetal alcohol syndrome, and you have to give health education to reduce the intake of this particular drug. Then going towards the family history, you have to take family history of different diseases which are present in the close family, for example, diabetes and hypertension, because it can give a clue that in subsequent, in this pregnancy, in the following time period, this particular lady can develop the risk of getting diabetes and hypertension, etc. And you also, it is recommended that you must take a history of multiple pregnancies. So it makes a comprehensive history which includes multiple components in the history taking of a pregnant lady who reports to you and who is a booked case, or even if it is an unbooked case, you have to take the complete history of this lady who comes to you with the pregnancy reporting. Then the physical examination. Again, the physical examination has multiple components in which you take the general physical examination, and then you have to do the systemic examination to see what are the effects of the comorbidities which are associated. Then there is abdominal examination. There are associated interventions associated with these examinations. For example, giving supplementation of folic acid, giving supplementation of iron, advising TT vaccines in addition to doing the physical examination. So there are certain important components. For example, the weight gain should be assessed in every antenatal visit. Blood pressure and general physical examination should be done in each visit. Abdominal examination should be done to measure the girth of the abdomen, and it is important that you do the examination to assess that is the baby growing well by assessing the fundal height, and through abdominal examination you can also assess the poles, and you can assess the limbs, etc., and you can also assess what is the position of the fetus. And the other counseling sessions can be conducted during the examination as well. Going towards the examination in detail, first the physical examination. The anemia can be detected, and the palate can be checked in the subconjunctiva, in the hands. And it is recommended that if a pregnant female comes to the tertiary healthcare center or the secondary healthcare center where the provision of checking the CBC is there, CBC should be checked regularly to assess the hemoglobin level. And if she reports through a basic health unit where only hemoglobinometer is present, where you can assess only hemoglobin instead of going for the CBC, you can you should go to check the hemoglobin levels, because the anemia is very, very common, and about 64% of the population in the females in Pakistani population have anemia. Another recommendation during general physical examination is to go for pulse. Ideally, it should be between 60 to 90 beats per minute, and if it extends more than 90 beats per minute, it can indicate the increase in temperature. It can indicate it can also indicate that the female is having anemia, and compensatory increase in pulse is there. So it is an indication of the general physical state of the pregnant female. It is important to go and check the edema. If the edema is present at night and it goes away after the rest of after the rest and sleep of about 6 to 7 hours, it means it is normal and it is normally present in the normal pregnancy. But if the edema does not go away and the female complains noticing the swelling, it can be an indication of pregnancy-induced hypertension. It can be an indication of getting towards preeclampsia. So it should be taken care of. The blood pressure is very, very important. As I have already mentioned, pregnancy-induced hypertension and associated preeclampsia and eclampsia can be a major cause of mortality in females, in pregnant females, as well as they can result in stillbirths. So the blood pressure should be monitored very effectively, and the blood pressure of more than 140 by blood pressure of 140 by 90 millimeters of mercury is considered as the high blood pressure, and for at least 4 readings should be taken, and They should be 4 hours apart, and as soon as the pregnancy induced hypertension is diagnosed, it should be started with the treatment. And then the weight gain, ideally a female gains about 10 to 12 kgs of weight throughout in one pregnancy, and if she's gaining weight adequately, it will help the fetus to gain weight. And if the maternal nutrition is inadequate and the weight gain is inadequate, it can lead to intrauterine growth retardation and low birth weight babies, and the birth of the low birth weight babies. So it should also be taken into consideration that weight is not increasing at alarming rate, because it can be an indication that the female is getting edema as well. Another recommendation by WHO is that you should go for the breast examination. You should look at the nipples, that whether they are inverted or they are adequate for the breastfeeding. And you should counsel the female for the breastfeeding to the newborn baby as soon as she delivers. Going towards the abdominal examination, which I have already mentioned, is very important. You have to measure the fundal height. By the use of fetoscope, you can hear the fetal heart sounds. after the 5 weeks of pregnancy, they can be audible. And then fetal movements, which can be assessed during examination. You can assess the fetal pulse. And in the mid-pregnancy, fetal lie and presentation is important, because if there is breech presentation or transverse presentation, you have to plan for the different modes of deliveries. And if there are multiple pregnancies, if there are any scars, and then assessment of the gestational age is done. And the fundal height is assessed in relation to the LMP, which is last menstrual period, and the expected date of pregnancy. When we talk about the uterine size assessment, on 22 weeks, the fundal height reaches the umbilicus, and after that, for an increase of 2 inches can be monitored, which shows different weeks duration. Which can be assessed easily, but it should be correlated with the ultrasonographic findings as well. So regarding investigation, as soon as the pregnancy is reported, you have to check for the pregnancy test. Hemoglobin estimation, as I have already mentioned, that majority of population is anemic. We have to go for urine examination. Any presence of pus cells can indicate infection. Proteinuria can be an indication of impending preeclampsia and eclampsia. Any presence of sugar traces can tell us about the development of diabetes. Blood grouping is important, and the Rh factor is important. So that should be done. Blood sugar testing can be done, and it is now recommended with the increase in hepatitis B and hepatitis C. The government has recommended that each pregnancy should be screened for the hepatitis B and hepatitis C, and ultrasonographic findings should be incorporated for the with the findings of the antenatal care examination, and they should be correlated. Then there are certain warning signs. The pregnant lady should be informed about these warning signs, that as soon as she detects these warning signs, she should directly go towards the healthcare facility. She should not wait. If there is development of edema, if there are any types of pets, if there is headache and blurring of vision, if there is excessive vomiting, any type of hemorrhage, fever, then these are the warning signs which should be, she should be counseled for, that whenever she develops these type of signs, she should be rushing towards the healthcare delivery system. So the warning signs include any type of hemorrhage can result in vaginal bleeding or vaginal discharge. The vaginal discharge can be because of the premature rupture of membranes. So she should be counseled for them. If there is swelling of face and fingers, it indicates development of edema. Continuous headache also is a sign of development of pregnancy-induced hypertension going towards preeclampsia. Dimness of VN, again a sign of pregnancy-induced hypertension. Any abdominal pain is an indication of any hemorrhage, which is undetected. Persistent vomiting can end up in because of diabetic ketoacidosis, or it can end up in electrolyte imbalance. High-grade fever is an indication of septicemia. If there is dysuria or frequency of micturition is there, it can indicate the presence of urinary tract infection. And if there is change in the fetal movement or no movements are felt, again, it's a warning sign and she should rush to the healthcare facility. The interventions which are recommended during the antenatal care services is the iron supplementation, as anemia is very common. And these are brown tablets which are given free of cost at the basic health units in the rural health centers. Recommendation is to give folic acid in the first 3 months of pregnancy because they can avoid the congenital malformation. Recommendation is to give the tetanus toxoid vaccination to this pregnant lady, and we will be discussing that. Two doses are required. The first dose is given at the 7 month, and the second dose is given 4 weeks after the first dose. And two recommended TT vaccination TT doses are actually recommended by the WHO, but this is replaced by the TT vaccination schedule of the reproductive age group, which we have already discussed. Health education must be given, and we will be discussing it in detail in our next lecture. Home visits are recommended by WHO, that even if the female is coming continuously for the antenatal care services to the healthcare provider, it is advised that the LHWs and LHVs should go and visit their home, and they should particularly visit their home if they are planning to have home deliveries as well. And there should be development of the referral system in case of development of any danger sign or any warning sign. She should be counseled that if this this sign develops, she should not waste time instead coming to the basic health care facility where the provision of emergency obstetrical care is not there. Proper referral systems should be developed. So any question regarding this particular lecture are more than welcome. Thank you.